NASA scientists have reported something remarkable about the lightning-scarred planet Mars. For over 2 years, the rover Perseverance has been documenting direct evidence of lightning on the red planet. Utilizing the rover's SuperCam microphone, the scientists were able to identify a total of 55 electrical discharges based on their acoustic and electrical signatures. Unsurprisingly, the lightning was usually associated with the leading edge of dust devils and dust storms. Indeed, for decades, planetary scientists have recognized the existence of powerful electric fields associated with dust devils and dust storms, both on Mars and on our own planet. Over 2 decades ago, meteorologists discovered dust devils on Earth that exhibited electric fields in excess of 4,000 volts per meter, and which also generated magnetic fields. But of course, Mars is a very different environment than ours, with an atmosphere only about 0.5% as dense as Earth's. It is in this alien environment that Mars produces the largest dust devils ever seen in our solar system, reaching as high as 20 kilometers. And even more amazingly, we see congregations of dust devils driving the most powerful dust storms which engulf nearly the entire red planet. When it comes to the powerful electrical phenomena associated with dust devils and dust storms, the question of cause and effect illustrates a fundamental theoretical difference between mainstream theory and the electric universe. Mainstream theory states that charge separation is caused by the movement of air in a dust devil, whereas the electric universe states that the dust devil itself is an effect of charge recombination. With this in mind, consider the following statement from a recent Science Alert report on the Martian lightning. It states, "Interestingly, a high concentration of dust in the atmosphere wasn't enough on its own to produce electricity." Now, before I explore dust devils and other major dust-raising events on Mars in more detail, I'd like to take a minute to explore the ongoing, unresolved mystery that is lightning. In dozens of previous presentations, we've discussed scientific discoveries which undermine and virtually invert traditional ideas about the cause of lightning on Earth. This includes observational data dating back decades, linking increased terrestrial lightning with dramatic outbursts from the sun, a phenomenon with no explanation in standard meteorology. This is especially important to consider when looking at Martian lightning, since Mars does not have water clouds like Earth. For some invaluable insight on this issue, let's consult the late physicist Wal Thornhill from the synopsis of his website, holoscience.com. "Most people are unaware that we have no understanding of how lightning is created in clouds. The simplest answer is that lightning is not generated there at all. Clouds merely form a convenient path to Earth for electricity originating in space. Without clouds, it is possible to have a, quote, bolt from the blue. That is happening on Venus, although the sky certainly isn't blue. Weather systems are driven primarily by external electrical influences. Consequently, the sun has weather patterns, and the most distant planet, Neptune, has the most violent winds in the solar system, though it receives very little energy from the sun. Electric discharges from space cause Mars's huge dust devils and planet-wide dust storms. They are responsible for Jupiter's Great Red Spot and the spokes in Saturn's rings. It is why Venus has lightning in its smog-like clouds, and its mountaintops glow with St. Elmo's fire. It is why the Earth has lightning stretching into space in the form of red sprites and blue jets, and why tethered satellites, quote, blow a fuse. However, nobody is trained to consider electrical energy input to weather systems." Now, to emphasize the points that Wall just explained, let's look briefly at the most intense form of electrical discharge on our own planet, in the upper atmosphere above powerful thunderstorms. A few years ago, we reported on an important breakthrough in understanding gigantic jets which sometimes reach as high as Earth's ionosphere. The video clip you see on your screen was shot by a pilot named Chris Holmes, which reveals critical features never before seen in such a discharge. An investigator named Oscar Vanderveld split the footage into individual frames, as seen on your screen. He describes what we can observe as follows. First, relatively cool blue filaments spring up. These are streamers akin to St. Elmo's fire. Next, after the jet reaches its maximum height, another feature crawls more slowly out of the cloud top, a white-hot lightning leader. An article on the website spaceweather.com describes why this is a problem for conventional meteorology. It states, "Some researchers thought that giant jets could reach such extreme heights only if their streamers got a boost from the lightning leader. Holmes' video shows just the opposite. The gigantic jet reaches the ionosphere before the lightning leader even leaves the cloud." Oscar Vanderveld concludes on these findings. "This suggests that there may be a much more powerful configuration inside the thunderstorm than was previously thought, perhaps as much as 200 million volts. This revelation becomes more powerful when we consider the lightning research of Professor Edgar Baring and what he found when he flew a high-altitude balloon above a thunderstorm. He made the unexpected discovery that when lightning strikes occur both above and below a cloud, the electrical charge was already present and did not take time to build up between lightning strikes. This contradicts the notion that lightning is the generator of the clear air electric field, measured at about 100 volts per meter between the Earth and a clear sky. In standard theory, lightning's generation of power requires water droplets to separate charge in clouds, a process that remains mysterious and unverified. The electric universe, however, sees lightning and the cloud activity as a, quote, load that is being driven by the sun. It is the electrical circuitry between the sun and the Earth that ultimately drives all lightning." As already mentioned, for decades, scientific research has revealed evidence of a direct correlation between intense solar activity and increased lightning on Earth. Indeed, in 2014, scientists in the UK reported an increase in lightning strikes for up to 40 days after a solar storm. Of course, on Mars, the environment is very different, with no water clouds, no thunderstorms, and no global magnetic field. However, the electric universe theory has always posited that the Martian ionosphere is indeed electrically charged. As Wal Thornhill wrote in 2005, "On Mars, electrical effects will reach directly from the ionosphere to the surface without the ameliorating leakage via storm clouds that we see on Earth." And the, quote, "electrical effects we see most clearly on Mars are the enormous global dust storms and other huge dust-raising events." As we reported a decade ago, astronomers were puzzled by observations of huge, so-called plumes of dust that erupted up to hundreds of kilometers above the Martian surface. However, a team of scientists using data from the Mars Express spacecraft made the completely unexpected discovery that Mars was hit by a coronal mass ejection immediately before the plumes were first spotted. As investigator David Andrews of the Swedish Institute of Space Physics stated, "It's very surprising that was affecting Mars right before the plume was first observed." And the obvious implications of an electrical event were acknowledged in a New Scientist report, which states, "One possibility is that plasma could be interacting with ice grains or dust lower in the atmosphere and electrically charging them, boosting them higher, but it's not clear how the effect would be big." In fact, we see an interesting analog to the Martian plumes on our own moon when it meets Earth's magnetotail once a month, producing dramatic dust-raising effects, including dust storms and electrostatic dust fountains. We also see analogs in the so-called plumes of jetted material, exploding hundreds of kilometers above the surfaces of the moons Io and Enceladus, of the respective gas giants Jupiter and Saturn. And we see it in the explosive cathodic jets of comets, whose collimation and extreme velocity remain mysterious for astronomers. Again, I refer back to the aforementioned scientific analysis on Martian lightning, which acknowledges the surprising discovery that, quote, "a high concentration of dust in the atmosphere wasn't enough on its own to produce electricity." For decades, upon seeing this type of acknowledgement from space scientists, I always feel hope that we may be close to a fundamental breakthrough for the concepts of the electric universe and plasma cosmology. I then remind myself of a phrase which was popularized in a work by Lord Tennyson nearly 200 years ago. "So near, and yet so far away."